that's actually what you get. So that was the 1D case. In the 1D case, we have an analytic solution. But real reservoirs are not one-dimensional. They also don't have equation, right? Real reservoirs have spatially varying permeability, porosity, other material properties, time-varying viscosities, formation volume factors, geometries that are 2 and 3D and irregular, right? They're not just, turns out you can even solve that equation in 2D on a regular, you know, on a rectangle, right? But real reservoirs aren't rectangles. And so, also, if you solve it in 2D, you have to, you know, the boundary conditions have to be nicely behaved on the boundaries, right? Whereas in real life, your reservoir is going to have wells all over it, right? They're not going to have perfect, nice, no-flow boundary conditions on the boundaries. You're going to have irregular wells all over the thing. You're going to have irregular boundaries as you get complex boundary conditions and other things. And so in 3D, you have to solve the full equation. You know, here are the permeability. I guess there's still an implicit assumption of isotropy there, but not homogeneity. So this is inside the divergence operator. By the way, just to be picky, this should be dot. So it's a divergent. That's the divergence of this. Anybody know why that's important? I think I talked about it a little bit, right? So if you have the gradient of pressure, what is, like, pressure is a scalar, the gradient of pressure is what? A vector, right? If I don't put that dot there, that says that's the gradient of a vector. What's the gradient of a vector? It's a second order tensor, right? On this side, what do I have? A scalar, right? So I can't have a second order tensor equal to a scalar. And so that's a way to check your equation. So always make sure all the terms have the right, if they're vectors, they should equal vectors. If they're tensors, they should equal tensors. So in this case, if this is a gradient, then I take the divergence of that, I get a scalar. So anyway, so real reservoirs are complex. This is the equation we have to solve in real reservoir. And by the way, this equation is just for single phase flow. We're going to do multi-phase flow before the end of this class. So how are we going to do that? We're going to take our complex reservoir and we're going to break it up into little pieces. And in all of those little pieces, we're going to assume constant properties. And we're going to figure out a way to turn those partial derivatives into discrete things. That's essentially the process of breaking it up. So that was our Rubik's Cube. And then once we break it up, we're going to have a set of coupled algebraic equations that we can write in matrix form in a nice compact way, right, that we're going to solve for the unknown pressure in a computer. So by the way, when you saw my lecture, and I was deriving it by hand, this is what I was using to do it, right? So that's how I was doing it. That's why I bring it to class. I've tried with Surface Pros and everything, but this was made for like graphic artists, and so the touch, the feel of it feels the most like a normal pen than anything that I've used. Surface Pros and iPads just don't quite do it. Okay. So now we're going to start to talk about, we have our equation for single phase flow. So now we're going to start the process of discretization. We're always going to start in 1D. We'll work through sort of all the derivations in 1D, and then we'll refer to the nodes for 2 and 3D, and things get more complex. Okay. So just as a reminder, our equation in 1D that. So we have a first derivative in time and a second derivative in space. And we want to come up with a way to discretize those or turn this partial differential equation into a set of algebraic equations. So if I had a function of x, pressure is a function of x, say it looked like that, and I asked you, what's the derivative of that? In words, what's the derivative? The derivative of a function is also a function. So you can't really say, tell me in words what the derivative is. In going somewhere? So you can't really tell me in words without saying, you have to say, well, the derivative of the function at a point is the line tangent to it, right? So if I pick a point, we'll just call the point xi for now. So if I pick a point xi, then yeah, the derivative is the tangent line to that. So what then is the equation, or what is the derivative of that tangent line? I mean, how do I specify that tangent line, right? It's the slope, right? The slope of that tangent line. But in order to compute the slope, I can't do it with one point, right? If I don't know the function, I can't just compute it with one point. So I can approximate the tangent with the secant, right? So if I take another point, right, we'll call this point xi plus 1, then, you know, the actual derivative, the tangent, is really close to the secant there. And of course, as my point xi plus 1 gets closer to xi, as that distance shrinks, then the tangent approaches the secant. Right? And I get a better and better approximation of the derivative. So, you know, just graphically, I can write down that, trying to use colors when something's significant, but graphically, the derivative is approximately and that's sort of what you learn in Calc 1 is the definition of the derivative, right? And the limit as the denominator goes to 0, right? So you might call the denominator, I think in Calc 1 you probably called it h. Here we'll call it delta x. So it's this distance. So in the limit as delta x goes to 0, then, let me just be really explicit. If I define delta x as the distance between it, then p at x I plus 1 is p at x I plus delta x, right? Then in the limit as delta x goes to 0, you get the derivative. Right? That's how you define the derivative in Calc 1. Right? But in this class, we're going to be doing numerical analysis, and it's important to understand the accuracy of our solutions. Right? And so if I asked you, give me some quantitative measure of how accurate that derivative, that approximation is. By the way, this has a name. This is called a forward difference approximation. So if I said, how accurate is the forward difference approximation of the derivative? Well, just based on what we have here, we don't know, right? There's nothing you can tell me about it. So We're going to use our friend, the Taylor Series expansion. So in general, for a function, evaluated at a point xi, the Taylor series is this. So plus dot, 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 because it's an infinite series. So then if we apply that to our problem up here of interested in trying to figure out what the pressure is, the derivative, or trying to figure out what the error of this approximation at xi is, then I have plus higher order terms. By the way, I'm using the shorthand notation that p prime is the first derivative with respect to the argument, right? So that's p prime is partial p partial xi. I'm sorry. It's I'll just be explicit. P prime of xi is equal to partial p partial x evaluated at x equals xi. Likewise, second double prime is second derivative, and so on. So now I can actually solve this Taylor series. I can solve it for p prime. Right? So I just move this to the other side of the equation, and I move these higher order terms to the other side of the equation. So if I do that, higher order terms. The Taylor series is an infinite, so I'm only going to write down the first term. So also keep in mind that this is delta x if it's constant, right? I can call that delta x, I can call this delta x. So then to answer our question about the error, by the way, this should not be squared. That should not be squared, right? When I solve this, as I move this over to the other side of the equation, and I want to solve for that term, so I have to divide the whole equation by delta x. When I divide the whole equation by delta x, I'm dividing this term by delta x, and so one of those goes away, and that leaves me with this term. So to answer the question about the error, then, the first order, the four difference approximation, has the error that's on the order of, and we use something called big O notation here, on the order of delta x. So big O, the big O means that there's some constant, that the error is less than some constant times delta x. Okay, so the terms that are there may be negative. It doesn't matter. Yeah. It doesn't really matter because we're just ignoring them. We're just using them. They're just folded into this error, right? So it doesn't matter. The error is the error. It doesn't matter if it's plus error or minus error. That's why the absolute value signs are. This will be a normed error, which holds for higher dimensions. Okay. So the error of the forward difference approximation is on the order of delta x, which means, you know, if I divide delta x by 2, I cut the error by 2. If I divide delta x by 10, I cut the error by 10. So as delta x gets smaller, I approach the exact derivative. Okay. So likewise, in the same way that I chose, you know, to evaluate at xi plus 1, I could have also just as easily done it at xi minus 1. And if I do that, I get a backwards difference approximation. And I'll spare all the details because they're not that interesting. But if I did a backwards approximation, then what I'm going to get is p now at xi minus p at xi minus 1 all over delta x plus the same order on the error on the order of delta x. Right? So forward backward which one's better? Neither one, right? They're the same. They have the same error. So one's not better than the other one. They have the same error. But we might also, what if we, instead of evaluating the function, you know, we want to know the derivative at xi, but instead of using the functional evaluation at xi, what if we evaluated at xi plus 1 and xi minus 1, and then approximated the tangent as the secant between those two? So that's sort of averaged over two delta x's, right? So this is delta x, that's delta x. And of course, you know, just graphically, the derivative then would be p at xi is equal to p at xi plus 1 minus p xi minus 1 all over now, 2 delta x. So that's just graphically what I did there. That's the derivative, so p prime. So then the question might arise, well, what is the error associated with that? Okay. Well, to find out that, what we'll do is we'll just take the forward difference approximation. And I'm just going to say for the function at x plus delta x, to subtract then the backwards difference approximation. So the backwards is x minus delta x is equal to p at x minus Now notice in the backward difference approximation, the odd terms, the odd derivative terms, have negative signs in front of them. So when I distribute, when I do this subtraction, I distribute the negative sign through, then all the even order terms are going to cancel. And I wrote them like that so that you clearly see, like this cancels, that cancels, right? And then ultimately, what I get, p at it's from the Taylor series. I didn't write it out, but it's just, that's just from the Taylor series. If you do a Taylor series expansion of the function of x minus delta x, right, as delta x goes, you know, gets small, then that's what you get. Right. So if I just subtract the two, then I get this. I can solve this equation for the first derivative by dividing by 2 delta x. Right. So I just divide both sides by 2 delta x. That cancels there, and then if I want to move, you know, this is my error, but I can also say that that's on the order of. Remember, I'm dividing by 2 delta x, so if I divide by 2, those 2's cancel, which don't really matter. But then I divide by delta x here, then this becomes a 2, right? And so what I get is something that's on the order of delta x squared. Right? So this is central difference. So let me just. I'll write out the whole equation. Central difference. So that's approximation of the derivative evaluated at x is so I can actually say quantitatively this is a better approximation because it's on the order of delta x squared, which means that if I cut the error by 2, if I cut delta x by 2, the error goes down by 4. Right? If I cut it by 10, it goes down by 100. So this is a better approximation. So you might ask, well, why not do this all the time? Right? Well, it has to do with that you have to do two functional evaluations all the time, like one in front and one behind. Whereas sometimes you could get away with only, you know, if you're doing a forward difference approximation, then you can evaluate the function at x once, and then you can evaluate it at, well, I think that's better left to be in practice, to be demonstrated in practice. But the sort of cost here is that you always have to do two functional evaluations to get this, which might, in some cases, lead to a greater computational expense. We'll see that later. See you Wednesday.